to apologize for the background noise that you can hear. This is an international conference, and all the sessions are being translated into several languages. And not only are the speakers dynamic and temperamental, but the translators as well. And this is what we can hear in the background. Our next speaker is a very interesting personality from London, Robin Shepherd. And he has been involved in the struggle against regimes which try to oppress freedom. Primarily, or in the past, it was communism with extensive knowledge in Eastern Europe and Russia. And now he's standing up against injustice in public speech that we hear, especially in Europe, directed against Israel. And we will hear from him what the connection is. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to be back here in Budapest. I was here last year as a sort of advisory capacity to the World Jewish Congress's conference in this very hotel last May. I'd also like to thank Danny Dayan for a terrific and very interesting talk. There obviously is an overlap between what he's discussing about the state of Israel, the two-state solution, which is the sort of default assumption that runs around the international community. But even more widely than that, and this is where I think there is a sort of segue into what I want to talk about today, it's very much a time when we've got to think outside the box. And people in Europe know that it's not just a question of thinking outside the box in the Middle East, it's very much these days a question of thinking outside the box in Europe itself. And I was reminded, whilst Danny was talking, that he mentioned the New York Times and that clicked in about the United States. In America, you're always supposed to start a talk or a speech with a joke. I notice I'm gesticulating with my hands, although I'm not Jewish. Danny reminded us that Jewish speeches are done with their hands. And I thought it reminded me, actually, in a strange sort of way, of my favourite, or one of my favourite Jewish jokes. And there's a kind of segment of Jewish jokes, probably coming from Russia. I used to live in Russia, and I speak Russian. And the point about Russian jokes is that you never laugh at them. But they are funny. That's the thing, they're anecdotes. And they're funny in that they're good as anecdotes because they have a point. So I was going to try one out on you, which is one of my favourites, about the great drivers of history. And it's about famous Jewish figures or people of Jewish origin and relating it to the human body. What are the big drivers of history? And in the beginning, there was Moses. And he said, look, it's all up here. It's all in the mind. That's the great driver of history. And then along came Jesus. And he said, no. It's all here. It's all in the heart. And then along came Karl Marx. And he said, no. It's all here. It's all in the belly. And then along came Sigmund Freud. And he said, no. It's all down there. And then along came Einstein. And he said, and it's all relative. As I said, I like it. You don't fall on the floor with laughter, but it's good for you. A few years ago, I wrote a book called A State Beyond the Pale, Europe's Problem with Israel. And what I tried to do was to look at what was going on in Europe. This was 2009, so I was writing sort of 2007, 2008. And if you remember, that pretty much from the time of the Second Intifada, and that was the key moment for me, the anti-Israel narrative had got very, very powerful. And I wanted to try and work out, what was behind these narratives. And the central theme of my book was this civilization question. And it exists on several levels. I won't go through all of them. I don't want to repeat the main points of my book, but just to give you some pointers. One of them, and I think this runs through the narratives, or sort of the subliminal narratives, if you like, of European discussion. One of them, of course, is the Nazi past. There's a sense, certainly in parts of Europe, of evening up the score. This was a terrible shame never mind the fact it was a tremendous tragedy for the Jewish people, it was a terrible shame on Europe. And there has been certainly an aspect of wanting to say that whenever the Nazi party refer to it, but look at what they're doing now, they've got a state. And there are many opinion polls which back this kind of, if you like, sort of false equivalence. It also applies, and since we're in Hungary, this is one case, but there are many, many places where there's a great difficulty in dealing with the country's past because of the way that the Nazi regime collaborated and worked with regimes in the wartime period in Central and Eastern Europe. Another part of it is the liberal left political media establishment, which has had this kind of obsessive hostility to Israel due to things which I refer to as third worldism, the idea of that in any kind of conflict between what would be seen as first world or Western people or state or institution in conflict with a third world or perception of a third world people or movement, the default assumption is always to be on the side of that third world people or movement. It's also obviously related to post-colonial guilt. And the third element, as I say, although there are very many more, but it's one of the really big ones, has been the alliance between the very far left and radicalised sections of the growing Muslim population in Europe. I would emphasise it's not the whole Muslim population, it's not the majority of the Muslim population, but it is a section of the Muslim population of Europe which has formed a kind of ideological alliance, the so-called and well-known Red-Green Alliance, and very much focuses on hostility to Israel and very much brings in extreme anti-Israeli and anti-Semitic narratives. So when I was looking at all this in 2009, what struck me most was how similar, although there are differences of emphasis, how similar these big narrative themes are all across certainly Western Europe. It is a bit different in Central and Eastern Europe, where it's arguable that it's more of the kind of old-fashioned style anti-Semitism, but there's much less of the neo-anti-Semitism, there's much less of the visceral hostility on university campuses, in trade unions, in the media, to the state of Israel. So what I want to do in this discussion is talk for about 20 minutes, and then leave plenty of time for discussion so that you can be the ones who define what we talk about as much as anything. And I want to talk about three issues. First, some brief remarks on BDS, the primary objective, really, of the anti-Israel crowd in Europe today. Second, a look at the new front, as it were, which I'm going to talk about, which is the neo-Nazi and far-right groups that have arisen in Europe. And third, how we should understand Europe today. And that comes back very much to this point about thinking outside the box. And I warn you, especially members of Parliament here, first of all, you'll think that I'm being very typically British, and probably I am, but it is going to be something you'll find controversial and probably unusual in terms of the way I want everyone to at least start thinking. I'm going to go as far as to say you're going to agree with me, but start thinking about modern Europe today. So, to me, one of the points to bear in mind about BDS, boycott, divestment, sanctions against Israel, is of course that it's almost always failed. It's something that it fails because we stop it, but it has failed. And I think it's very important to, for the sake of morale, if for the sake of nothing else, to remind ourselves of that. And it comes back to what I said a moment ago. Back in the early 2000s, 2000, 2001, 2003, it seemed as though the anti-Israel crowd had pretty much all of the territory under control. It seemed as though that the pro-Israel groups were not prepared, perhaps haven't even been created. The Israeli embassies did the best they could, but they were fighting often single-handedly. But what I think we've seen is that pushback can work. And it comes from, you know, the great and one of the most famous lines from Shakespeare's King Lear, where he's speaking to his only honest and truthful daughter, who, in response to what he says he will give her, what will she give back? And she says nothing. And he famously says, nothing will come of nothing. And that is a fundamental point to bear in mind. If you don't actually stand up, if you don't actually start writing, you don't start acting, nothing will come of nothing. You You will remain in the same dark place you were before. And the, if you think on another side, a more modern analogy, about political psychology, and if you think perhaps of the other socialists, the sort of trade union style socialists, and of course I'm thinking in my own country of the English working class in the early part of the last century, the latter part of the century before that. And what the trade union socialists always said was that the greatest problem they faced was not from the police, the industrialists, the capitalist class. It was from the fatalism of the very people they wanted to help. If you believe you're in a tunnel with no light at the end of it, why bother even trying? Fatalism won't produce pushback. So obviously nobody in this room is or should be anything other than a million miles from complacency about boycott, divestment and sanctions. But the fact that we have actually defeated it on so many occasions should really be remembered, because it's that very sense of having done something successful that will energize us to continue doing it in the future. BDS is both symptom and cause of something wider, and that is the new anti-Semitism that posits Israel as the ultimate evil in the world. It sees the Jewish people as incarnated in a state, the modern day mutation of the Nazi ideology that came before it, positing the Jewish people in Europe as the ultimate evil which needed to be destroyed. I think that the pushback has worked because our arguments are sound and the cause is just, but also because we've had the energy. But we must never cease to stress the core moral part of the case, never mind the rational, diplomatic, geopolitical part of the case. And that is that anti-Zionism is the number one bigotry in the world today. There is no bigotry that is more widespread, no bigotry that aims at annihilation as an end result, and there is no bigotry that, and this is the crucial point, that is more widely shared inside the mainstream. There are all sorts of other bigotries around the world, and terrible bigotries they are, and all of them need to be destroyed. Racism against non-whites, against black people, is a terrible bigotry, but it has been largely eliminated from the mainstream, which doesn't make it something we should ignore when it appears elsewhere, but it makes it a different and, in a sense, less dangerous animal than the animal of the new anti-Semitism. What I want to do, though, now, moving on to the second part, is to draw your attention to an older aspect of anti-Semitism, which has been renewed in the form of neo-Nazism in modern Europe. And again, it's where it occurs in the mainstream, where it gets itself into the political system. That's what most concerns us. Three parties. I'll actually show you a report that I helped produce for the World Jewish Congress. This is an updated version, and you can get it from the World Jewish Congress. They'll happily send it to you. And it looks at a whole variety of case studies. Well, it has three case studies, and it has looks at several other instances across Europe. One of the key things is that when you're looking at neo-Nazism, just like when you're looking at anti-Semitism in a more broad sense, you shouldn't expect it to appear in the same form and manifest itself in the same way as it did in the 1930s and 1940s, any more than the anti-Semitism of the 1930s and 1940s was the same as the anti-Semitism of the Middle Ages. You know, it will adjust itself, it will mutate. So you need to understand, I think everyone needs to bear in mind, that few, if any, political parties in the 21st century could be expected to be exact or near exact replicas of the Nazi party that ruled Germany from 1933 to 1945. And so if somebody says, oh well, Golden Dawn in Greece or Jobbik in Hungary, look, they're not the same as the German National Socialist Party. Well, of course they're not the same. The fact is that they have, at base, core similarities which make it worthwhile to describe those parties in terms of being, as I recall, neo-Nazi.